I'm particularly excited that with the Everon's new venture, we are able to transmit it to thousands of people all over. So what was until now a private affair, war grounds, can now become that degree of knowledge can be exposed across the medical profession. So this is my team, Dr. Neha, Dr. Adhavan, Dr. Dilip, and Dr. Parveen. We're going to start the war grounds. Please come along on this journey with us, a journey of teaching and what we would do in a surgical war ground over a 20 to 30 minute period.
Okay, Rajkumar. Rajkumar?
Yes, sir.
One request. You can hear me?
Dr. Muruganathan?
Yeah.
You can see. We're starting here with. Yes, sir.
Yes. Dr. Jailal is here. You wanted to say hello to him. He's right to me. Dr. Jailal.
Oh, wonderful.
Hello.
Dr. Jailal is such a. Dr. Jailal, hi. Such a pleasure to say hello to you. You're doing a fantastic job.
Program and it's a good response. And CGP is becoming Rajkumar's fans.
Well, I'm a big fan of Dr. Jailal and Dr. Muruganathan. I said, I'm myself your fan. Now, this lady, we are seeing her in the fourth post-operative day. She came in with massive obesity and also with a problem in the uterus, with a bulky uterus, with a menorrhagia. Let us move along and have a look at her CT scan. You can see that she's got a huge amount of abdominal wall fat here, a fairly bulky uterus, but otherwise no other major abnormalities. About 4 days ago, she underwent a double procedure. One was a laparoscopic sleeve gastrectomy, like the one that you just saw. But we also removed her uterus at the same time. And this is the appearance on the third post-operative day. Nalla irukkeengalama? Comfortable? So obviously, as I said, we don't need to transfuse patients who have laparoscopic hysterectomies or bariatric surgeries. This is the drain you saw at the end of the operation. We put a drain. She's got only about 58 cc, which is not much to worry about. But here is the interesting part. Before the surgery, her blood sugars were always 270, 280, etc. You can see that she has not yet lost weight. She will lose weight only after about, in 1 month, she loses 10 kilograms. But let us ask her, find out about her blood sugars.
129, sir.
129. Insulin,
sir.
Nothing. Here, feedback. I don't know if you all can hear me, but her blood sugars are now 129, 3 days after surgery. It used to be 275, 280, etc. See, this is good. 2 years she has been a diabetic. We find that if you operate upon patients within 10 years of their discovery of diabetes, you can change the diabetes significantly in these patients. That is what we are seeing. Also, she's quite chubby, so you're not able to put in any peripheral lines. That's why we have got a central line. But we'll soon be removing that, and within 2 days, she will be home. Nadakringla? Unmaiya sollunga. Nadakringa. Okay, good. Also, we will do one more test post-operatively. We will give her a little dye, take an X-ray, and make sure there is no leak. She should be home within a day or two. So the carry home messages that we have here are, one, that these surgeries significantly change the diabetic status of the patient. With a bit of luck, she will not be taking any tablets at all for diabetes. Two, we don't have to give them blood. Three, you can do multiple procedures, uterus, plus bariatric surgery, gallbladder plus bariatric surgery. I know various combinations like that.
Rajkumar,
and of course, yes sir.
How often you see myxedema or thyroid disorder in these people?
Good question, sir. Most, at least 20% of patients will have a mild hypothyroidism. But I would like to take up this excellent point brought out by Dr. Muruganathan and say that thyroid is usually an excuse. You have a fat lady. You say, why are you so fat? Thyroid problem. Please remember, 3 to 5 kilograms of excess weight can be attributed to the thyroid. But the rest of it is a primary morbid obesity. Having said that, we always check the T3, T4, TSH for these patients. And those patients who have a thyroid problem, we correct it before we operate upon patients. But the classical picture of huge myxedema is very rarely seen in the morbidly obese patients. There is a mild hypothyroidism as well. So this is a picture of Mrs. Junaida Begum, who will be able to move back home. Good. Thanks. Sir, I would like to mention a few things to the audience. Looking after a morbidly obese patient post-operatively is not a joke. Very often they require to be ventilated post-operatively. We have separate mattresses that will hold a weight of greater than 200 kilograms. The anesthetic process is different. The intensive care process is different. And just now, of course, in the last 10 years, we've got it into a swing. So the whole thing is protocolized. But otherwise, you can have a lot of problems while setting up a bariatric care unit. From here, I'm going to move you to a very interesting patient. Many people think surgeons don't have to have an interest in physiology. But you will find that this is a patient whom you cannot treat unless you are very familiar with all aspects of GI physiology. So very, very interesting, one of the few in the world, and I'm happy to have an opportunity to present him to you. Mr. Purushottaman underwent a vagotomy and GJ for ulcer disease. Yevla varshathukku munnalinga our first operation pannadhu? 1987, that is 23 years ago, he underwent a procedure, vagotomy, GJ. I'm sure many of you, Dr. Murunathan and all, you would have seen thousands of patients who underwent this operation. Then in 2002, he underwent a cholecystectomy, all at various other centers. But I would like to point out that ever since 1987, for the last 23 years, he is having a very crippling, disabling diarrhea. And this is called post-vagotomy diarrhea. Other than, yeah, come on, sir. This is called post-vagotomy diarrhea. I would like him to, it's a very cooperative patient. You'd like to, he'll be able to show you his scars. You can see this is the scar of the gallbladder operation that he had in 2002. Elsewhere, we do them mostly laparoscopically, as you know. This is not done by me. And initially, he had a, what's called a vagotomy GJ. And after that, he became crippled with diarrhea. Now, most of you practitioners, when you see a patient with diarrhea, we give them some loperamide, some codeine sulfate. Sometimes you give them some norfloxacin, tinidazole or ofloxacin, tinidazole. This is a man who was passing, you know, watching a daily?
Nearly
15, 16 times daily, having watery diarrhea flushing out. And he lost
33.
He lost a total of 33 kilos. Please understand that the GI physiology is very exciting. And when you do a vagotomy in GJ, in a small proportion of people, because we are cutting off the vagus, the acid does not prevent, there's not enough acid to prevent the overgrowth of bacteria. So these patients start developing a bacterial jejunitis, one. Two, apart from this area of bacterial jejunitis, secondary to the vagus, they have, some people have something called denervation hypersensitivity. The vagus normally causes peristalsis. When your vagus is cut, some people start having excessive peristalsis, as this poor gentleman. When such a patient comes, It is not enough just to give him some codeine sulfate. We have to work him up completely. So he had an upper GI endoscopy, which showed a normal GJ. He had a colonoscopy to look for something like a colitis or infective conditions, negative. He had a barium study to study the small intestine, and that showed his small intestine was running like a shatabdi. Then he had a capsule endoscopy, thinking there could be some lymphoma in the small intestine or something that could cause a diarrhea, but he had no lymphoma, nothing abnormal in the capsule. So from mouth to anus, structurally Mr. Purushottam was found to be normal. Then we checked for B12. B12 was normal. Folate, normal. Thyroid, normal. Rest of the endocrine workup, normal. CT scan, normal. And still you have a patient struggling, losing weight. Indeed, Mr. Purushottam and his wife came to us and said, even if I die, I don't mind, please do something to save me. So we used an operation that's very, very rarely used these days. It is called jejunal interposition. Now, please look at my sleeve. It's like the gut. The gut is going down. The gut has got a peristalsis going down like this. Supposing it's like this, going continuously from the right to the left. Imagine if I remove a segment of gut in between, turn it ulta, and switch it back. In other words, there is a segment of gut in between that is turned upside down, and that causes what we called reversed interposition of a jejunal segment. And that is what we discussed with him. It's a major procedure because you're removing 3 feet of jejunum and you're putting it back ulta. But Mr. Purushottam agreed for it, and this is what we have finally done. We opened him up and took out a loop of intestine in between. We first checked to see if there was anything wrong, and we did this jejunal interposition. It's a very difficult thing to do, a major operation, without definite proof. There is no definite proof that it will work, but there are only some things that you can do for these patients, because for from 87 to 23 years this man has suffered. And we did this about a month ago. We did this operation, and within a few days after operation all his diarrhea has settled. இப்போ எவ்வளோ வாட்டி போகுது? He says one time or sometimes two times. You can see from 15-16 diarrhea bouts, he was having his newspaper in the bathroom, then he was having a library in the bathroom, he was having his stereo set in the bathroom. He was spending most of the time in the bathroom, I think. Now Purushottam is spending some time in the rest of the house also, not only in the bathroom. And we are very, very happy. We've actually sent it off for publication, because this is one of the rarest cases ever done. Sometimes when you interpose and reverse the gut, you can have a little bit of partial intestinal obstruction from time to time. But he is ready for it, and most importantly, he is now looking so much better in the last 1 month. So what we have presented to you is a rare case in the ward round of chronic, intractable, refractory diarrhea after a vagotomy GJ, which was completely investigated biochemically and imaging wise, radiologically, and for which he finally had a reversed interposition of the gut. But you can see his general nutrition is good. Please see, when he first walked into my office, he was having pedal edema, and the presence of pedal edema means that the patient's albumin is low. If the albumin is low, the chances are he will not tolerate a major operation. So when we admitted him, we had to give him albumin, slowly bring him around, and then bring him back to normal. Please also note that the skin is shiny and ichthyotic, like fish scales. Ichthyotic skin in a patient who has had a vagotomy GJ means that he probably has been having vitamin D and vitamin E deficiency as well because of his diarrhea. Anyway, now that we have corrected the diarrhea, it's only been about a month, slowly this ichthyosis, the pedal edema all will go back. Last albumin has also come up to 3.5, 3.5. We had to pour in so much albumin into him to save him, that the God has been kind and he's all right now.
Has he improved weight, Rajkumar? Weight?
Yes, sir. His continuous weight loss stopped, and he has put on 2 kg. He has put on about 2 or 3 kilograms, but this man was actually losing about 1 kilogram every month for the last few years. So now, in the last 1 month, he has increased 2 kilograms. His albumin, which is a very good indicator of nutrition, has come up to 3.5. At the time of surgery, it was only 2. He was having pedal edema, and now the pedal edema has become all right. We have not done the serum transferrin, etc., because he is doing very well. But if you check the serum transferrin, the serum prealbumin, etc., you will find that all the nutritional indices for these patients improve. So doing a functional operation like this is much more risky than doing a structural operation. Somebody has a big cancer, you cut it off. It's a structural operation. But this is a functional operation where you have to make sure that the patient is all right. But fortunately, in the case of Mr. Purushottaman, he became quite all right. Now, as doctors, we have to, especially in surgery, we have to take some risks sometimes. Now, I would like to introduce you to, hello Nihar. This is a young man called Nihar who has come all the way from Kolkata. You can see his, he had first gone to CMC Vellore, where he was diagnosed with a very rare condition, a giant hemangioma of the anterior abdomen and the chest wall. These are his CT scans. And if you see his CT scan, you can see this big fat bulge in the anterior abdominal wall. You can see this whole thing is a huge tumor of the anterior abdominal wall with an extension into the chest, intrapleural extension, with an extension into the abdomen. You can see this huge hemangioma here, with a little bit of extension into the preperitoneal space. So this is a giant wall, anterior abdominal wall hemangioma. You can see that here also, huge, giant one, extending into the chest, extending into the abdomen, going up to the pericardium, going up to the left ventricle. You can see a portion of it has come up to close to the left ventricle, close to the pericardium. In some of the cuts, there was actually extending very close to the left ventricle. And so one big, huge mass, you can see this picture here. And you can see this, these lower pictures, so-called longitudinal scanogram. This is the chest, this is the abdomen. You can see this whole thing is a giant hemangioma with some calcification in it. He was refused surgery on the grounds that the risk would be too high and that he would die on the table. So he had one or two injection sclerotherapies. But what happens to hemangiomas is that these hemangiomas bleed. He started having recurrent bleeding into the hemangioma, causing his hemoglobin to fall and causing him to become hypotensive. So somebody has to bell the cat. So we talked to him, Nihar, and we took him up for a very, very major surgery in which we excised the entire, you can just lift it up, just the front. You can see we excised the whole hemangioma from the chest and abdominal wall going all the way inside. I told you that even for a Whipple's, for the last few Whipple's operations, pancreas, duodenum, stomach, everything being removed, we hardly give blood, or we give one or two units, except if they have some post-operative bleed or something. Otherwise, we don't give blood. Uterus, we don't give blood. Bariatric, we don't give blood. But for him, because of this hemangioma was so bloody, we gave 45 units of blood. I think 46 or 47 units of blood is what our Nadamadam Rathavangi, Dr. Vijay Kumar, has given. I think that we would have required all his blood volume, because 45 units of blood had to be given. He was bleeding and bleeding and bleeding. And fortunately, you can see still there is some bleed. 10 days. 12 days, oh yeah? 12 days now after the operation. And even 12 days after the operation, you can see there is still a little oozy. But fortunately, we managed to resect very aggressively, take out this tumor. The point of the matter is that he is now practically cured of this disease, which was troubling him for the last 10 or 15 years. Yes, we were very worried the way he was bleeding, how we could stop the bleeding. But fortunately, using all the gizmos, modern devices available, and suturing again and again, and giving 45 units of blood, we have saved him. And kab jare? Kal. Tomorrow he is going back to Kolkata. So this is just an example to show that in the life of a surgeon, we have to take these risks in a young man. Fortunately, his father His brother, all of them are also willing to take that risk with us, because they had been obviously in another institution. They were told that it's better not to proceed. So they took that risk, and because they were also fully with us, thank you, sir. Because they were fully with us, we were able to operate and remove this very, very huge giant hemangioma from the chest and abdominal wall. Quickly on from there, I'm going to, what happens if a young lady has got a swelling, which could be a swelling because of ascites, it can be an ovarian tumor, it can be a uterine tumor, it can be a lot of things. So as we work up the patient, we do a CT, we do an MRI, we can see what's happening. So this young lady had ascites and liver disease. I would like to point out that not all liver disease is incurable. Most of the time, by good medicines like diuretics, liver support, beta blocker to prevent bleeding, B complex, zinc, and non-specific hepatotrophic drugs, we can keep them going quite well. So this is one young lady, when she came into us, she had quite significant pedal edema. Now she doesn't have any pedal edema. She had ascites, and now her ascites become completely all right. Now when we see liver disease, we have to ask ourselves in the South Indian context, whether it is due to alcohol. Is the lady is a housewife quietly working away? Unlikely that she is a raving alcoholic. I have not seen her in any of the clubs or any of the bars. Second, it could be due to a virus, could be due to hepatitis B, or can be due to hepatitis C, and we ruled out both those. You can see a little bit of ascites, tiny bit of ascites still in this patient. So here I would like to stop for a minute, and I don't know whether you're able to see in your pen. If you look carefully, Emma Periya Moochudunga, you can actually see her spleen. Mark Pandra. Now I'm just going to request her to take deep breaths. I just want you to see. And the best way, can you see the spleen moving up here? The best way to make out the spleen is something that I would like to demonstrate to you. It's called Schott's maneuver. You turn the patient in the right lateral position, lift up the hand of the patient, put your left hand onto the left costal margin of the patient, and allow her to relax. This moves ascitic fluid. It moves ascitic fluid and it moves the bowel downwards, giving us a chance to put the hand, the right hand here. And this, can you see this whole picture? This is called Schott's maneuver. You show this here. And I can see her spleen, feel her spleen so beautifully here. Big spleen here. Schott's maneuver. Okay. So left hand up, your left hand on the patient's left costal margin, your right hand near the umbilicus. Make the patient take deep breaths. In these days of ultrasounds, and CT scans, and MRI scans, we should not forget straightforward clinical medicine, which is the bedrock based on which complete modern medicine is built. Also, I would like you to take a note of the single red spot. You know, Sherlock Holmes said, with one single clue, you can solve a murder case. You can see here, you can see this combination. You can see this? One red spot and a spleen. You can just see it's like a clue. One red spot and a spleen is equal to liver disease. Why? Because in liver disease, because of increased portal hypertension, you have the so-called spider nevi or the spider angiomas. And also you get a splenomegaly. So this lady actually is a classical case of portal hypertension due to cirrhosis of the liver. Tell me two or three common causes of cirrhosis of the liver. Hepatitis B, hepatitis C, alcoholic. Hello, Dr. Murugunathan? Dr. Jailal, it's clear? You can see that. You can feel the spleen. Are you able to see the spleen and the spider nevi? Dr. Jailal?
Jailal is not there.
Dr. Murunathan, you are there. So you are able to see the spinal nevi and the outline. Sir, if anybody has any doubts, please ask them to feel free to talk to us. We can interact as we move along.
Rajkumar, can we see your palm? Palm or erectum is there? Palm.
Oh, yes. You can show this. You can actually see there's an, it's a small, it's a bit of palm or erythema. There are, there are five things to be seen in the hand in liver disease patients. First is clubbing, which he does not have. Second is white nails or leukonychia, which he does not have. Third is red palms, which he has got to some extent. Fourth is a Dupuytren's contracture, which he does not have. And patients with advanced liver disease tend to have a little bit of cyanosis. That also she doesn't have. Interestingly, this lady was part of a clinical trial in which she underwent cell-based therapy. She underwent stem cell-based therapy. 3 years ago. And she has remained quite asymptomatic for the last 3 years after giving her, we took out her stem cells from her bone marrow, incubated them with hepatotrophic factors, and then injected them. And obviously 3 years down the line, she remains completely well and asymptomatic. One more point I would like to ask all of you. If you see ascites, what type of portal hypertension is it likely to be? Somebody in the audience may, because portal hypertension can be because of a block, thanks Mark, can be a block in the portal vein, it can be due to liver disease, or it can be due to disease like schistosoma, etc. Again, inside the liver, but pre-sinusoidal. Let me tell you that if you see ascites, it is most likely the cause of the portal hypertension is post-sinusoidal. Inside the liver sinusoids is where the lymphatics of the liver come in and join. So we now know that ascites is due to a weeping liver, and the liver weeps because its lymphatics are blocked. Therefore, in sinusoidal and post-sinusoidal blocks, you develop ascites. For example, in Budd-Chiari syndrome, where the hepatic veins are thrombosed, you get the quickest onset of ascites. If you have pre-hepatic portal hypertension, like for example splenic vein thrombosis, you will not get ascites. Ascites means either liver or after the liver. These are simple tricks. Finding a large spleen and no ascites could indicate that we are dealing with pre-hepatic portal hypertension. So by looking at a patient itself, to some extent, we can have a clue. Obviously, after that, we are going to do a CT or MRI, MRCP, etc. Now, talking about liver disease, we have talked about an older lady with liver disease. This baby is how old? 14-month-old baby who's only 9 kilograms in size. She looks happy now, but I can tell you she was not a very happy baby sometime back, because her whole abdomen was occupied by a big tumor. And I would like to, you can all see, let's have a look at, invite you to the, have a look at a 64 slice CT. You can see here, somebody passed me a pen again. You can see this is a longitudinal scanogram of this patient. Please note that this is the liver, colon, and entire abdomen is completely occupied with this huge mass. You can see this is just, the mass is 2 to 3 kilograms. It was finally, when we resected, 2 to 3 kilograms. And the papa's body weight is 9 kilograms. So nearly 33% of our body weight. What possibilities would we like to think of? I know there will be a lot of pediatricians in the crowd. Maybe I'd like to like them to interact. What would they think of in such a possibility?
Wilms tumor.
Yes, always Wilms tumor is one of the things that you must think of, because it's one of the causes of a large tumor. But I don't know whether you're able to see in some of the shots, you can see a fairly normal kidney on both sides. But yes, it could be a Wilms. It is more anteriorly placed. Any other guesses? Yes, Wilms is one. Neuroblastoma is always another possibility. As you know, an adrenal neuroblastoma and a Wilms from the kidney are the two common possibilities.
Cholangioma, sir?
Sorry, what is it? Who said?
Cholangioma. Cholangioma.
Listen, cholangioma is a very rare condition, and it's not usually large, it'll be much smaller. But what I want you to appreciate in this, can you see in this, do you think this tumor is homogeneous or is it heterogeneous? See the liver on top. Liver is homogeneous. Just below the liver, this is attached to the liver. But can you see how it is? There are multiple areas of necrosis inside the tumor. Can you see these black areas? These black areas in a CT scan indicate that contrast has gone into the liver. And wherever contrast is gone, it's white. Wherever contrast is not gone, it's black. So there are multiple areas of necrosis, or multiple areas where the blood is unevenly distributed. Please remember that the commonest tumor arising from the liver across all age groups is still a hemangioma. In an adult, it can be a small hemangioma. In a child, you can have larger hemangiomas. So seeing such a variegated appearance of the tumor should bring up the possibility of what we call a giant hemangioma. Now, what we are worried about was that the liver is already very vascular. Hemangioma is full of blood. This child's weight is 9 kilograms. The entire blood volume of this child. Any guesses on the blood volume of the child? It's 80 milliliter of blood per kilogram. So a 9 kilogram child is going to have a 700 to 800 cc blood volume. Out of the 700 cc, I think about 200 cc is already sitting inside the big tumor. So you can understand why, understandably, we were all terribly worried about operating on this child, because you lose so much of blood. Sometimes in a major liver resection in an adult, we lose 2 liters of blood. This child has got only 700 cc of blood. Even if you lose 200 cc, it's 1/3 of the blood volume. When you lose more than 20% of the blood volume in a major operation, there is a high risk of the patient going into shock. So to look at the differential diagnosis, most likely that this was a hemangioma. Now I'm going to ask all of you again. It's a large hemangioma. Even if they touch the child or hold it this way or that way, knock it, can bleed and die. So we have to save the life of the child. Same time, when I operate, if I operate straight away, we may spill too much blood and we may lose the child. So I would like to ask the audience, can you think of any in-between maneuvers to decrease blood loss during surgery? Any radiologists there?
Rajkumar?
Yes, sir.
They request me to wind up in another 1 minute because the other person is waiting in the studio. So,
oh, that's fine.
Can you summarize?
This is the last patient anyway. So,
hello.
Just to tell you, I will finish correctly, not to worry. What we did for this patient was we did an angioembolization. Many of you people who come across patients with large tumors, You should look at doing an angioembolization. We were able to successfully do, I will take you to the baby now. Do an angioembolization followed by surgery. You can see the marking and the angiopoietic mark. You can see the little bit of a mark and a small hematoma on this side through the left thigh. They did an angioembolization and they were able to embolize the blood vessels and decrease the size of the tumor significantly. On down the church, church, church. And then you can see we operated on this patient and removed a huge tumor. Three times during the operation, the baby went into hypovolemic shock. But each time, by giving 50 cc of blood and 30 cc of blood, we were able to bring the patient's blood pressure back up. Pressures went as low as 40 by 0. Fortunately, she picked up towards the end of the operation. It's now 6 days after surgery and the baby is very well. So this is a quick kind of roundup of some of the work that we do and the ward rounds that we do. I know that we've had only 20-30 minutes. Thank you, Ma.
Rajkumar, on behalf of all of us, you know, well done. Thank you very much for the wonderful clinical rounds. Over to Jayla.
Thank you, Rajkumar. Incidentally, Rajkumar is a professor of our college. So it is the IMA College of CGP is proud to say our own professor, Dr. Rajkumar, has demonstrated excellently well in this program. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Jayla. Thank you, Dr. Murugan. Thank you, one and all, once more. It's been terrific talking to every one of you. Good day. And thanks again to everyone as well for having done that.